welcome to our wonderful homeland in the Blue Ridge Mountains. I'm an alchemist, Tesla scientist, whatever you want to call me. I like to play with science in different ways. And I'm involved in several projects here in Asheville. One of them, which we're trying to restart back up, is the Tesla Tree Project. I have a 27-foot Tesla tower in slight disrepair after a Manhattan man stole it. Might sound familiar if you guys know Tesla. And trying to bring free energy to the world. There's lots of different ways to go about this. And so I've been doing this lecture series around the country called The Science of Sentience. However, I already did this lecture last time at the Spirit Science Gathering, so I'm going to do something different. And I made a lot of these metaphysical toys, one of them being these star coils. Star coils I've been working on, theoretically, for over 4 years now, to where I've been able to manifest them to this point. I'm going to be taking them up a step more from this. This is being forged in terms of being a blacksmith, which I've been doing for over a year now. Is with 3D printing and getting them mathematically perfect. But I want to explain what this really is, and the significance of what this is going to do to our plane, technologically, socially, consciously, however you want to apply it, can be applied across the board. And what that coil is that's the Star of David, that's the hexagram. A lot of us are familiar with the symbol of two triangles overlapping. But there's a little bit more to it than meets the eye. So I want to dive into that, into the mind's eye, and explore this. And so one of the things with the lecture series, The Science of Sentience, is talking about science itself and what is science. And that math has been such a, just the word math just triggers people. It's a turnoff because of how we've gone about it. And while the math we do, it's this linear, masculine, quantitative system. But there's this whole other aspect, this feminine aspect, that's cyclical, that's qualitative. Well, what happens when you mix the circle with the line? You get the spiral. And that's how reality manifests, is the spiral. And so what I've been doing is comprehensively integrating different sciences together. The mass, the biologies, the physics, the chemistries, and bringing it all together to start seeing this underlying fractal pattern. And so what I want to get into is talking about the dimensions to understanding this. And one of the things, the paper I've written more than any other papers, is I've written multiple papers on dimensional theory. What are the dimensions? And in the metaphysical community, people keep talking about the fifth dimension, the sixth dimension, the 12th dimension. But who here actually knows the first dimension, or the second dimension, or the third? And there's very few people that actually understand what's going on in these basic dimensions. So the papers I'm writing is focusing mostly on those three dimensions. And the best way to understand those dimensions is how information travels through those dimensions. So in the first dimension, Tesla discovered something called scalar waves. And scalar waves have been proven to be faster than the speed of light. Scalar waves are helical waves. Well, in the second dimension, I consider electromagnetic waves or light waves. And a lot of us think light is this third dimensional thing, but look around us right now. What do you see? Light is reflections off of 2D surfaces. Even when you have a laser pointer, the only way you can see the laser pointer, it has to reflect off particles in the air. Light is a second dimensional phenomenon. And as we call it electromagnetic, there's two polar pairs to light, electricity and magnetism, the two different axes of information that make up light. And so the light moves as a toroidal field, a donut. It radiates outwards from the central axis. Third dimensional information is sound waves, acoustic vibrations, sometimes even said mechanical vibrations, and they radiate out as spherical waves. And so what I've been trying to do with physics is simplifying these things down to basic vibrations, helical, toroidal, and spherical waves, and how they interact together, and how you can transmit energy back and forth between these dimensions. Now, there's also a dimension a lot of us talk about in terms of black holes, and that's the zeroth dimension, and that is the densest of the dimensions, in that it's a single point in space, in that if you have a grid, we have this little point here on the carpet, and this point, if we create this point, it's the infinitely small, or everything around it is the infinitely large. We're having a densest piece of compression of space. space-time in this one point with the greatest expansion around it. And so what I'm getting at is one of the fundamental laws of physics, one that we've not put as much focus into, and the way physics has been going has been somewhat hypocritical in ignoring it. And that's Newton's third law of motion. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. This is the law of yin and yang. And so the Big Bang, this beautiful thing that we all talk about in physics, there's this big problem with it at the same time in the Big Bang, in that they talk about having all these densely packed particles into a single space expanding rapidly. However, let's get back to Newton's third law. And for this to happen, there has to be an equal and opposite reaction. And so physics has really started to focus on particle physics. But do you ever hear about vacuum physics? It's for the particles to exist, the vacuum must exist. And so the process of the Big Bang is the process of space-time moving from a neutral state, a completely neutral static state, with no information applied to it, suddenly becoming full of information. What happens in this process of manifestation? And this process requires a rapid compression and a rapid expansion at that same point. And so the Big Bang is a process of particles coming into manifestation and a vacuum coming into manifestation. What we've forgotten so much about is the midpoint between the vacuums and the particles. And so one of the things we're trying to do in the free energy movement is, how do we create a mini Big Bang? How do we replicate this alchemical process of manifestation, polarization? And so with these coils, what's great about these coils is how they trap light. It's a very simple thing. It's almost like you could get those Ghostbuster traps, how they trap the ghosts. We're trapping light in these guys. And it's working right now. You don't have to plug it in or anything. It's just understanding how the material and the geometry is working together in this very moment. And so if light is this 2D thing, is this the second dimensional construct, when you start to understand this, you can start to work with it appropriately. But there's also two parts to this geometry game. One of the big sciences I like to play around with is material science. I'm understanding how different materials work. I've been playing with crystals since I was a little kid. I'm just obsessed with them. And I eventually expanded into metals. I'm understanding how metals and crystals, which we call dielectrics or insulators, are these polarities, and how you can make these polarities work symbiotically together. That's what I do with these wands. How these wands work symbiotically with the quartz crystal and the copper. And so, for example, quartz crystal has a property called thermoluminescence. I actually did not go to school for any science. I took one physics class in high school, and that was it. And that I stayed a lot away from the traditional sciences. Quartz has a property called thermoluminescence. And what I did go to school for was archaeology. And in it, I learned about thermoluminescent dating. And they take a black tube, and they stick it into the sand, and they pull it out so there's no light exposed to the sand, and you get dug down like several feet, and you go into a lab, and then you'd be able to see how much light is being emitted by the sand, ever so slight amount, but you get this very accurate dating. So even 20,000 years later, quartz is still emitting light. So the interesting things we talk about is, oh, I want my quartz crystal into the sunlight to let it charge. You are letting it charge. It's emitting light right now. As soon as this guy gets some sunlight, he's emitting so much more light out. This quartz is absorbing UV radiation, it's transmuting it, and it's putting out visible wavelengths best. It's putting out orange, red, and yellow light very effectively. Well, what happens? What's copper do? Copper reflects orange, red, and yellow wavelengths very effectively. And so you're getting a symbiosis between these two materials. And this wand is made of a triple helix. And there's a core in this triple helix. This core is like an inverted triangle. It's full of air, and so it's a dielectric, and it's sending the light down this chamber. And it's reflecting it off the copper and refracting it, which is the opposite form of reflection, through the air. What's great about the triple helix is how it refracts it in a special way. And it's a fractal refraction. And so when light hits water, it refracts at a specific angle. Well, what happens when you refract it and then you refract it again at that same angle? The triple helix, it's 30 degrees in terms of what it refracts. So it refracts at 30 degrees, at 30 degrees, at 30 degrees, forever. It's a perpetual, never-ending refraction. And it refracts it and compresses that light to a single shaft, a single axis in that wand. You're compressing that light as dense as you possibly can get it, and it's coming out the tip of this wand. Okay? And so, one of the things in physics that we're having a hard time to do is we're building these giant toroidal machines, these tokamak reactors, and we're trying to contain extremely hot, dense forms of energy, and it's been extremely hard to do this. And big reason why is because of how we're not using geometry correctly. When you start to use geometry correctly in fractal forms, you can contain this energy and make it extremely, extremely dense in a point of space. But remember, if you're making energy extremely dense in a point of space, you have to allow it to be extremely expansive around it at the same time. For example, lightning, okay? Is when we think lightning, and there's two types, positive and negative, but I'm going to use negative lightning later, is when we have a cloud, there's electrons. I do this for a reason, because in my opinion, electrons don't really exist, and they've set us down the wrong road in terms of understanding light. Is the electrons in the cloud are coming from the cloud down to the earth when the lightning strikes. We see this linear flow, but we forget about this perpendicular axis that's happening at the same time. That's much more important. And so, imagine that the earth is twisting. This is the basis of energy. It's twisting on the ground, and the energy is building up and building up. Same with the cloud, that's twisting in the opposing direction. And there's a point where the cloud and the earth can't hold that energy anymore, and it has to untwist, just like a metal spring. When it untwists, that's where you get the lightning bolt. However, when we see the lightning bolt, you forget about the magnetic field at the same point. And that the lightning bolt is space-time, which I like to call the ether, rapidly collapsing into the single shaft of light. But at the same time, you have this rapid expansion of the magnetic field at the same point. That's the thunder. The thunder is the actual collapsing of the space-time and the expansion at that same moment. And we usually think it's the lightning ripping through the air. It's not the lightning ripping through the air. It's the expansion and compression of the space-time. And so when you start to think about concepts like this, you can start to really understand what's happening in physics. And so I'll get more into the light coil now. And so this is made of steel, mild steel. And I use mild steel over, say, pure iron, so when it's easier to twist, iron's really brittle. When we add a little bit of carbon into the iron, it stabilizes the magnetic field. It allows me to magnetize this and maintain the magnetization. And so when this guy is all said and done, I let it cool in the magnetic field and I get red hot. At the same time while it's cooling, it grows a layer of iron oxide on it called magnetite. Magnetite is a really cool material. It is it's what we call a negative resistive oscillator, so it's spinning. It's a semiconductor. And what's really important understanding of the dielectrics, the semiconductors, the electrical conductors, and how they all work symbiotically together. An electrical conductor, we want to use as a reflector. We want to reflect the light. It is the waveguide, it is the conductor of the energy. So electricity, we usually have two properties, voltage and current, that we talk about. Current, you don't want current in your electricity. Current is a sign of dissonance. A sign of resistance. And when you get outside of out of current, you get into pure voltage systems. This is what Nikola Tesla was working on, is pure voltage. The voltage is a measurement of the pressure of light, how dense the light is at that point. So think of current and electricity, that when like light is hitting, say, a black shirt, you feel it get hot. That's where we're running all of our electricity. And that energy is getting absorbed into the copper and creating heat. It's a loss of energy. You don't want that. You want that light moving along the surface of the conductor. And the dielectric, the insulator, refracts the light. It bends it. And there's ways to get these two working together in harmony. The beautiful thing is a semiconductor. The semiconductor is what pushed forward our civilization of technology and computers and computer chips. And that it, think of being in a detective or a police station interrogation room with a mirror. there. It lets light go one way, but not the other way. It refracts it one way, it reflects it the other way. You're able to control which way the energy moves. That's magnetite on the surface of this coil. And so light is able to hit the coil, go through the semiconductor layer, bounce off the layer of the steel, and then bounce off the layer of the semiconductor. So what I just did with this coil is I effectively trapped the light in the infinitely thin boundary layer between the semiconductor and the conductor. But at the same time, you're not only just trapping it, you're trapping in a specific geometry. You're having that light move in a specific way. And the other thing, so I said magnetite is a negative resistive oscillator, and let's just work on the negative resistive piece. Resistance is, I was saying, a loss of energy. Well, negative resistance is a double negative. It's coherence. You're creating coherence of the energy. So it's able to take incoherent light forms, light constructs, light forms, hitting the coil, organizing it into coherent waveforms. And the waveforms that get stored in this hexagram are standing waves. And standing waves are a really important concept, which I recommend even going home tonight, tomorrow on Wikipedia and reading about the standing wave. And a standing wave is all this. Everything you are seeing right now is a standing wave. A standing wave is the illusion that something is stationary. A standing wave is the two waveforms hitting each other. You want to create three standing waves in this coil. And each of these standing waves are out of phase with each other, which we would say 120 degrees out of phase. So when one is at maximum expansion, one of these waveforms is, you could say, at a third of its strength decreasing. The other one's at a third of its strength increasing. And so all three of them are fluctuating out of phase with each other. And there's ways, there's multiple ways to replicate this. So today I wanted to do a ceremony where we can replicate this, taking the Merkaba meditation and stepping it up a bit, creating a little bit more coherency with our group in terms of how this works together. And so one of the things is, what do you think goes in the middle of this? Anyone have an idea?
Quartz crystal.
There you go. It seems pretty obvious. It's how this works with a quartz crystal. And it's a nice hexagon. Quartz crystal has two properties. One, the thermoluminescence that I was mentioning, and so it's emitting light, which, being this is black, this absorbs most wavelengths of light. But copper, as I said, works really well with it. However, the property we're using with the quartz in this ceremony is the piezoelectric. Who's here familiar with the piezoelectric property? Really?
Right.
So if you guys ever have, like, you know, a watch and it says quartz on it, it's using a quartz oscillator. And so do we have a quartz crystal laying around?
Yeah,
we need, like, a nice quartz crystal. I think I might have one here.
They're all crap.
Here we go. Right. So with a quartz crystal, if I'm squeezing right here on opposite sides, it's creating an electrical polarization perpendicular to it. So as I was saying before, that light is two-dimensional and sound is three-dimensional. And you also consider sound to be mechanical. And so me squeezing this, so I'm squeezing this once a second, I'm creating a 1 hertz sound wave, essentially. And you're creating an electrical polarization perpendicular to the squeezing mechanism. Quartz here demonstrates in itself that you're changing one axis of information to a perpendicular axis of information. You're changing the third dimensional information to the second dimensional. That's one of the cool things about quartz, is it's allowed to step up and step down between these two dimensional energies. Now, if we put this quartz in the center of this coil, right, and we have six groups of people around this coil. And the way we did it is we had three males and three females. And even if we have a lot of people, we're going to have a lot more than that. But three males and three females around this coil. And say we have one group here and there's one group over there. One of the things we're implementing in this ceremony are, I'm calling the antras. And the three antras, yantra, mantra, and tantra. which are all related to the Vedas. This here is a yantra. Some of you might be familiar with the Sri yantra. There's a bunch of different types of yantras. Yantra pretty much means a spiritual instrument. This is a spiritual instrument being used in many ways. You can use it to create energy. You can use it to power a UFO. You can use it in the ceremony to open a stargate. That's what we're going to be doing today on the equinox. And so, if you have these two groups, this masculine group and this feminine group facing each other, and you breathe in and then you breathe out in terms of tantric breathing, and you make a sound. The sound we're going to be making is ah. Again, ah for everyone.
Ah!
The sound of the heart chakra. The heart chakra is represented by the hexagram. The hexagram is considered the geometry that is the boundary between heaven and earth. So when we're opening up a stargate here, we're opening up a boundary between heaven and earth. Okay, this is this beautiful midpoint geometry in our reality. And so when we both do ah at the same time, you're having a sound wave hitting this crystal at the exact same point on both ends, which creates an electrical polarization perpendicular to it, which this coil reacts to. So what we're doing with the Merkaba meditation, we're taking it, we're putting it in a cyclical format, we're creating a round with it. And so this group goes ah, and then we have the second axis, this group going ah, and the third axis, the third group going ah, and going 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Now if any of you are familiar with Nikola Tesla, what he did in the late 1800s, around 1890, he developed the AC polyphase system, the three-phase alternating current system, which powers everything now. This was 120 years ago this was developed. And most people don't know about Tesla. I have a feeling there's much more people here do, but because of what he tried to accomplish and what he suppressed. We used to have a huge exhibit in the Smithsonian. It's not there anymore. Because how much they tried to take him out of literature. We all know about Edison, when Tesla made much more brilliant light bulbs than Edison. Anyways, the AC polyphase system, what I was just describing, is based on six coils. One coil is faced north polarity, one south polarity. They fire, the next two fire, the next three fire. Tesla figured this out 120 years, actually more than that, because it took a while for it to be implemented. And he won the contract for 50 of these generators to be built at Niagara Falls and became the largest power plant in the time on the planet. And Tesla said, if you understand the secrets, if you understand the numbers 3, 6, and 9, you understand the secrets of the universe. So today, we're going to explore the secrets of the universe. And one of the other things that I want to try to do, and this is going to be intimidating, is in this process, because we're not just doing six people, we're going to do a lot, so we'll see how this works, is the process of tantric eye gazing. And so gazing at one of your partners across the circle and making that connection. And so what we're doing in this is we're creating this resonance on all these levels. Resonance between you and your partner, resonance with our vocalization. We're creating this balanced moment, this very powerful balanced moment to allow energy to flow in ways we could never conceive of before. And so before we get into this, does anyone have any questions? With this thing, no, not with what we're doing right now. To do that, I'd be setting up coils and doing a completely different aspect. One thing I say about, say, a battery, as soon as you connect the battery, you're killing the polarity. You're losing your energy. You want to maintain the polarity. So like one thing I'll share quickly is with the Tesla tower, you're using the charges of the ionosphere, which is positive charge, and the charges of the Earth, which is negatively charged, to oscillate the tower. The tower is always being recharged by ions, the solar winds, and the lightning strikes discharge it. So you have a pulse. This actually relates to gravity. Gravity is actually a pulse. It's not constant. And you use the tower to oscillate in this. But I'm not actually getting the power from the ionosphere of the Earth. I'm using this to create a massive polarization in the tower. And with that polarization, I fire it through a spark gap. I create a little mini lightning bolt. But that spark gap is a negative resistive oscillator. And so you actually use the spark gap organize your energy. All the energy is coming from the spark gap. And then I take that and put that in what we call a capacitor bank. And then I have this energy to use. But then to say, and to use our normal electrical systems, actually have to convert it, which is actually an expensive, hard process to convert it to what we would normally use, because what we're using is unnatural electricity. What I'm getting the tower is a natural form of electricity. So that's really a whole other conversation, but if you want to talk to me afterwards, if you want to chill.
I just have a question about thermoluminescence.
Mm-hmm.
It sounded like you said that crystals illuminate light.
Not all of them, but some of them.
Oh. Well, the quartz does, right?
Mm-hmm. Quartz and fluorite are the big ones.
Okay, and what type of light do they emit?
Quartz emits, the best wavelength it emits is red, yellow, and orange wavelength. It's 520 to 700 nanometers. And the visible spectrum is like 300 to 700 nanometers. But it absorbs UV, which is below 300 nanometers best. So it takes that solar energy and transmutes it. Same with fluorite. Fluorite does it best. Fluorite's really good for electromagnetic radiation. That's what you guys want to keep next to your computers. And one thing I just love saying, get rid of your microwaves. Get rid of it. For a public service, to disassemble your microwave and donate it to my Tesla research. They are horrible for you. Absolutely horrible.
What would you do with them?
What I do with them? They have a high voltage transformer, they have a high voltage diode, and a high voltage resistor, and a few ceramic magnets that I can harness out. So.
Can you, like, make a video where you do that and show us how to do it? And
yeah.
Then we can send you the part for
sure.
Should you
like it? Yeah. That definitely works. Well, I think let's go for this. We have these things in the hole in the center. I think we'll have three groups here and three groups here. Put the coil right here. And let's try to see if we can organically break up into six groups. Males being in. So we'll start with a central group here of males, and a central group over here of females. And if for some reason you feel like really being a male and you're not a male, go for it. If you feel like being a female, go for it. It's about the energy you're projecting. And so males and females there.
Oh, I'm in front of someone's camera.
Let's go scope out the guys. Get all this?
So, in terms of like natural ebb and flow of pressure systems, let's see if we can distribute everyone evenly. So we need more females over here. Tons of males. We need males over there and over here.
So like male, female, male, female, and then
males. Yes. There's three males and males. There's three males and females.
I'll go over there.
So we didn't do a terrible job.
So basically, just breathing.
Who needs that?
Let's do a warm up all together. Well, the mantra of the heart sound together. Ah.
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 Right.
One more time.
Ah.
That sounds great. All right. So here's kind of the trick: is doing this in a round. And the big thing about doing this in a round is we're creating a triple vortex. And so even to start this, I'll share a little story quickly in that a synchronicity in that I have a really good friend from high school.
One question in terms of conductivity and electricity. Is it better to have shoes off to be better channels for energy or flow?
It would if we were standing on the earth.
Okay.
But we're not standing on the earth, so it doesn't really matter. I have a friend right when I was moving to Florida to go to school, go to college. She made me this pendant. She thought it was really cool, and it pretty much was an inverted Celtic triad. And she had no clue what it was. She'd never seen a triad before. She just thought it was a great thing that she just came out of, you know, her subconscious, and she gave it to me. And I'm not wearing it right now because a friend of mine, Sedona, has it. But it is always significant. It's like, what is this symbol? It's understanding this triple vortex, and that's what we're creating here, is a triple vortex with our sound waves. You don't even need the coil to do this. Even us just doing this meditation, we're going to be creating this, but we're taking all these different aspects and implementing it together. And so, circles. This is a big theme in seeing this triple vortex and how we create this unique, this very unique vortex, this powerful vortex in nature. And we're doing it together on the equinox in 2012 in the Blue Ridge Mountains. Let's try to do this tantric eye gazing. Don't worry. Oh. Organically find a partner to eye gaze into on the other side of the circle. If you can't find one, no worries. Just you know, be yourself and connect with that person. Feel that person. Because right now, what we're doing in this circle is we're just creating this very powerful reflection, this triple reflection of humanity around us. And now, here's going to be the tricky part. The tricky part is getting this round going. When I first tried to do it, it was a little hard, so you know, don't beat yourselves up. It's going to take a little bit, but I think once this gets going, we're going to really feel something special. Because I've also replicated this with fire dancing. When you do it, it's pretty crazy. And you can feel the energy spiraling in. So another thing to think about is you have all this compression of energy on this outer wall. There's this expansion in the center. And so the energy is going to be spiraling into the vortex. We're creating a macro-sized hurricane, or a micro-sized hurricane, essentially, right here. And so, let's start with this axis, and we're going to start slow and then pick it up. And so it's breathing in, and then breathing out the ah. And so, when this axis goes, then I'm going to signal this axis, and then this axis. And so maybe let's start with group. I'll just use numbers. This is group number one.
Suggestion. Six-sided tantra under here. Could we align our groups with the...
Alright, so we have one group here. Male, female, male, female, male, female.
Nice. We're good. We're good.
Female, male, female.
Not quite. Okay. males from over there could go there, and they are like two each or something, but that would.
And so if I understand, a female should be locking eyes with a male, ideally?
Yes, ideally. But again, we're not perfectly balanced in this group as is. So, let's go with it. So yeah, this is group number one. This is group number one, group number two, group number three. And so it starts with, you know, breathing out, breathing out, breathing out. But the idea is once I get this motion going, because I'm going to be conducting all of this, that as soon as you start breathing out, you're going to keep breathing, you're going to start to breathe in again while the other people are breathing out. And so it's trying to find the rhythm.
So I understand that maybe it's a question for others. The so is it more of a or is it more of a
we should start slower with the breathing out, but as it picks up, then you start breathing out the faster, it becomes more intense.
So it's like the Merkaba, that's what you say, it's like the Merkaba breathing, what we did with it. But a little slower in the beginning and then speeding it up. And you'll be conducting us on the street?
Yes.
Okay. Great. All right, I knew we did yesterday for a reason.
So the key thing also, and me being a dancer, trying to dance with other people and pick up on everyone's movements is a huge challenge. Fire dancing on your own is like easy. As soon as you start to get other fire dancers into the mix, it's a whole other ballgame. This is where we have to work together, and that you're going to start picking up this rhythm, and they're going to be picking up this rhythm, and you're going to be picking up this rhythm. And ideally, once I start it, it's like starting a car, 1, 2, 3, it should take off on its own. I'm going to still be conducting it and making it with the movement, but it's all of us tuning in with our ears and feeling that rhythm as it starts to pick up. And it's going to slowly pick up faster and faster.
Has everybody found somebody to lock eyes with yet? If you haven't, why don't you just raise your hands and we can pair up.
I'm presently looking at 3 people.
You're going to breathe out on your own.
Yeah.
Because he's going to go around the circle.
So it's like one, two, three, like that. And then it's like, and then it's
like, is it supposed to be drawn out?
It's going to be overlapping.
Let's all just do it together a few times with the rhythm and figure out the rhythm of breathing in, breathing out, and then we can split up. Splitting up is the hard part. I've tried it before. Alright, so. Ready? Alright, that's pretty good. That's the rhythm we should start with. That rhythm's just gonna pick up from there. But as that rhythm picks up, so does the phasing in terms of how we're all moving this way.
It's
really colorful skirt.
Yeah, right there.
It's
really colorful skirt.
The
hips. Not the hips, the hips. They're both.
Yeah.
Just keep your body there.
Oh, yeah.
You guys ready?
Yeah.
Alright. Oh.
We're rallying the stars.
You guys are all gonna be like, oh, yeah. The rest that are in 10.
Thank you.
Me too.
Thing is that we can take this and we can start doing this with our friends and ceremonies, and I'm planning on publishing more of the information, and that there's more than just the hexagram, it's the pentagram, it's the octagram, there's all these other cyclical geometries and how you can interweave energy. And the thing we could say through our exploration, just like how we're studying how quartz crystallizes this vibration, this has this vibration, is what do each of these different ceremonies, what's the different purpose of each of these ceremonies, so that we can start exploring. One thing I'm doing with the map is figuring out how these actual vibrations interact together. There's still this qualitative interpretation that we need to work on together. Mm-hmm.
I wanted to say a lot of these, this is a lot of new physics for me. Is there a way I can follow your work or research online or in a journal?
Yes. I have, my website is thoughtrevolution.info, and it has a link to my YouTube channel. I have over 150 videos. I've been trying to more coherently organize things and put together a video. I really want to do a short film called Ether and just start to culminate all of this. Sort of like what Thrive did, but Thrive focused more on the social aspects. I really just want to focus on the science of being yay. It's like really start getting that information out there. But my channel is just full of a mishmash of all this information that I've been doing it for several years. And you can follow me on that. And there's also my website has my Facebook and my couch surfing. I'm a huge fan of couch surfing.
Yeah.
Suggest all of you participate in it. It's a great thing for this world.
And it was Thought Revolution?
ThoughtRevolution.info.
Bright, white auras everywhere.
Let them in on this good vibe and take this vibration with you. You are all tuning forks. Like, when you go home, like, you're going to be in a car for a while and you're going to feel yucky and your chakras aren't going to feel good when you get out. Find ways in your life to carry this vibration. Meditate, of course. Find ways to laugh and to reduce stress and to bring happiness and just spread this. That's all the
and to offer, not just your friends, take it to your enemies.
Yeah.
out of the world.
Where's the drum going? Finally stop working on that hound.
Okay, I see what you mean.
Yeah,
you can say again for me.
I said that now that we completed that process, that you just guided us through the mines, can finally stop working on that long calendar.
So to share back my experience, mine was probably the most unique, being in the center.
Yeah.
It was a little hard conducting with that pole. It threw me off a few times. But what came into my awareness during it was when I was, how old was I? I was 13, and I went and sat down with, I don't remember her name, but she's who conducted the orchestra for our band. I played trumpet. And I came to her and sat down and told her, I didn't want to play trumpet anymore. I wanted to be a conductor. She's like, well, this is a big thing to take on. And she laid me all through it, and I sort of abandoned it. And I realized, I'm finally going to be a conductor. In terms of the intent I put behind it is when we breathed out the compassion, that was releasing all the energy back into the universe. Mm-hmm. And that was what I saw. That was my intent in terms of, you'd say, conducting the ceremony. That was the moment where we released all of it back.
And the crystal contained like the purest of what was harnessed,
yes,
from all of us,
and
right?
It's going to Las Vegas for a reason.
Can be done anyway. Actually, speaking of walking stick, I had one too that had all these carvings on it, and I haven't seen it since the first day of the gathering.
The black and red transmitter walkie-talkie.
Okay, it's a spirit lost and found.
And a purple mug with a choo-choo chain on it. Anyone sees that? Losing things.
We're missing things, but we're so full of love.
They're just things.
Yeah.
Who's finding your things? We fill that void with love.
Yeah, yeah.
Probably, yeah.
So to wrap. two things I want to say. One, all of my stuff, the coils, the wands, the pyramids, are available for sale down at the tent with Delia and Jade. I wanted to mention about Delia and Jade, and I was shocked to see them. And think of this synchronicity. The two people fire dancing last night happened to be both from Maine, and happened to be fire dancers who dance together regularly with the Maine Fire Dancing Collective in Maine. And this is the farthest gig ever for the Maine Fire Dancing Collective. October 19th and 20th with Alex Gray and Daniel Pinchbeck. Support. It's going to be my biggest gig ever. I'm really psyched about it. And the other thing, I'm not sure if it's been said, but I've seen them. I've seen them in action, but Forrest, Tori, and Jordan, who put together this event, and also Holly, and several other people. Just give them a round of applause.
Thank you, guys.
3L?
Thank you. 3DL.
3DL. Oh, 3DL, yes. Oh, yeah. And
where's
Scott? Well, we got Scott here.
He's right there.
Scott here has been organizing 3 days of light, and it's going to be redonkulous. It's November 2nd to 4th in Black Mountain. It's where the Leaf Festival, for any of you in the actual area know about Leaf, it's held at the same location. If anything, actually, Scott, you want to say something quickly about it?
It's a Soul Star family reunion. Have an idea in your mind of what you think, what part needs to come to
the world.
The world, you bring it and share it and talk about it. There's probably gonna be about 70 workshops, at least 50, 60 bands, art installations from all over the world, DJs, music, ceremony, lots and lots and lots of ceremonies. Yeah. So
very affordable and close.
Yeah.
And beautiful.
And a lot of us who are participating in this event here from the Asheville area will be there. A lot of the metaphysical community in Asheville will be there, and I recommend you all to come. It's going to be wonderful.
So I got something I want to say. If you guys remember the picture that we had from the last gathering, we all took the picture where we were all holding Jordan and Victoria up.
Yeah.
About half of the people at the gathering had already left when we took that picture. We need to take a group photo before people start taking off.
Yeah,
I want everyone to get together.
Yes.
And maybe Andrew, you can get that picture for us. And
absolutely.
Before people start taking off.
So when
are we doing that?
You see how
Thank you. best class in the
After lunch, more training.
Okay. I'm joining.
What?
Where's
Marcia?
Yo, gang, since we're taking a group photo. Thank you.
Yeah, I left my water bottle and the shoes.
I know that bird.
The picture came out really nice.
Like, oh, I'm
gonna think
he's okay.